Unser nächster Redner ist der Alex Mohobetswane Mashilo aus Südafrika. Er ist Sprecher der Kommunistischen Partei Südafrikas, hat promoviert über den Zusammenhang von ökonomischer und sozialer Entwicklung. Südafrika, Nelson Mandela wurde, der auch selbst Mitglied der Kommunistischen Partei war übrigens, wurde oft verglichen, also Abdullah Öcalan wurde oft verglichen mit Nelson Mandela. Die Kommunistische Partei Südafrikas ist heute gemeinsam mit dem African National Congress, ANC, und dem Congress of South American Trade Unions in der Allianz der drei Parteien, die bis heute die Politik seit 1994 bestimmt. Südafrika wurde nicht sozialistisch. Dennoch wird dort natürlich weiter gekämpft. Welche Möglichkeiten haben denn progressive Parteien im kapitalistischen Staaten im 21. Jahrhundert? Das ist die Frage, die wir an Alex stellen. Herzlich willkommen, Alex Mohobetswane Mashilo.
Thank you very much, and greetings to all. Firstly, the South African Communist Party would like to express its message of revolutionary solidarity with the people of Kurdistan. Comrade Abdullah Öcalan was a friend of our former president Nelson Mandela, and he visited him in South Africa. They had an interaction, and we have learned from one another. I must say that in my preparation to come to this conference, I interacted with comrades in the Zimbabwe Communist League, and they have requested me to pass their message of solidarity to the people of Kurdistan. Having arrived here and interacted with a number of comrades, I decided to adjust my notes a little bit to enhance the understanding of the alliance in South Africa. And I can see some of them are shaking their hands. Welcome. South Africa is led by a liberation alliance comprising of the African National Congress, which is the alliance's organizational leader, the South African Communist Party, the Congress of South African Trade Unions. This alliance is supported by an array of mass organizations, students in colleges and universities, in high schools, women's organizations, many, many, many organizations which together constitute what in South Africa we call the mass democratic movement. Now, the alliance led by the ANC is not a coalition. It differs from coalitions in the sense that we contest elections under one banner, which is the banner of the African National Congress. We do this because the historically oppressed, divided on the ground and on the ballot, might be defeated or might easily fall. Members of the Congress of South African Trade Unions and the Communist Party and all of the formations of the mass democratic movement are at the same time members of the ANC, and they have got to go through democratic processes in the ANC in order that perhaps they can be public representatives or so. Secondly, by contesting government, the alliance does not abandon mass mobilization. It is actually pursuing, both as an alliance and through the government, what we call organs of people's power on the ground, which run schools, which run universities, which are responsible for safety and security in communities, and you name it. So this alliance has won all general elections since the first democratic election in 1994 by overwhelming majorities, ranging from 62% in the general election held last year, 7 May, to 2/3 majority. At the center of the progressive politics advanced and bringing the alliance partners together and many of the formations which support the alliance is a vision of a future South Africa entitled the Freedom Charter. The Freedom Charter was mapped out in 1955 and it put several programs at the center of its strategy. Firstly, it recognizes that our people have been robbed of their birthright to land, liberty and peace by a form of government founded on injustice and inequality. The Charter then calls for the abolition of restrictions of land ownership on a racial basis and of all land to be redivided among those who work it to punish famine and land hunger. The Charter also recognizes that South Africa will never be a prosperous country until all its people, regardless of race, ethnicity, religious affiliation, or no religious affiliation, because it recognizes the rights of all to choose or not to choose religion. Until all those people live together in brotherhood, enjoy equal rights and opportunities, and it calls for the achievement of this society. Let me just summarize the economic program put forward. Let me just summarize the economic program put forward by the Freedom Charter. Firstly, restoring the wealth of South Africa and heritage to all its people who shall share in that wealth. That's very central, because people were oppressed, exploited, and excluded from the wealth that they produced. Secondly, transferring the mineral wealth beneath the soil, the banks and monopoly industry in the hands of the people as a whole. Thirdly, regulating all other industry and trade to assist the well-being of the people. Equal rights for all people to trade where they choose, to manufacture, and to enter into all trades, crafts, and professions. The rights and duty of all to work, equal rights for men and women, and for people of all races to receive equal pay for work of equal value, and to draw full employment benefits. That is just a summary. And the Charter puts forward social rights on a par with political rights. And amongst others, it calls for the doors of learning and culture to be open, free and compulsory education for all children. And it calls for, you know, university and college education to be open to all by means of state allowances and scholarships and the elimination of adult literacy. It puts in play, it calls for decent housing, family comfort and security for all. Very important, which we need to highlight, a point we need to highlight. When the colonial division of South Africa was imposed from Europe, our people were divided between borders. In South Africa, over 9 African languages and cultures were not recognized as part of the official languages and culture of South Africa. Our people were divided between South Africa, Botswana, South Africa, Mozambique, South Africa, Lesotho, South Africa, Swaziland. And in most of these countries, their majority are in South Africa. So the questions of democratic confederalism are very key for us as to how the nation is being defined and how this will be coordinated in the context of the existence of a state. The Freedom Charter aims to end what the South African Communist Party in its 1962 program, The Road to South African Freedom, refers to as colonialism of a special type, and to eliminate all forms of bondage. The concept of colonialism of a special type captures the reality of South Africa's past in terms of which the colonial oppressors lived in the same territory as the oppressed. This territory was, however, defined by the development of those who racially fell under the camp of the oppressor in class and racial terms based on the underdevelopment of the nationally oppressed. Colonialism of a special type fostered patriarchal relations of domination and varied this according to the regime of white supremacy. According to the program, the colonial status of South Africa as a colonialism of a special type was designed in the interest of imperialism when Britain conceded independence to South Africa in 1910, and the state in South Africa was established as the Union of South Africa from several provinces. Therefore, imperialism constituted the external dimension of colonialism of a special type. In other words, in terms of the world systems theory and the concept of development of underdevelopment, two interacting co-periphery colonial dimensions were structured, both involving the development of the core through the underdevelopment of the periphery. The external dimension meant that South Africa as a periphery was underdeveloped colonially through capitalist national exploitation to advance development in the imperialist centers as the core. The internal dimension meant that South African people, meant that the African people in particular, and black people in general, as I'm trying to go slow, the internal dimension meant that the African people in particular and black people in general, and let me explain the concept black people in general. We mean people of mixed race, we call them colors. There are Chinese in South Africa, they are recognized as black people. There are Indians in South Africa, we recognize them as black people. So the African people and all of these black people combined suffered varied forms of national oppression. So this meant that internally, this meant that black people in general and Africans in particular were underdeveloped to finance the development of the white minority. Now, progressive politics in South Africa as such are not only concerned with the elimination of the internal conditions and dynamics which constitute national oppression and exploitation. By their very origins and their line of development, they are equally concerned with the structural forces and underlying processes constituted by the global environment in which the internal conditions of oppression and exploitation were created, developed, and reproduced. Okay. Progressive politics in South Africa, recognizing the internal dimension of core periphery underdevelopment, in which the African people and black people in general were systematically underdeveloped, oppressed, and suppressed, to advance the development of the white minority on the one hand, which is the internal part of colonialism. On the other hand, which is the external part of colonialism, which was structured by Britain and later on taken over by imperialism, South Africa was exploited nationally as a country to advance development in the economies of the core which constituted the imperialist centers. And as such, there can never be complete liberation in South Africa only by eliminating the internal conditions of oppression. Progressive politics in South Africa therefore seek to eliminate colonialism in all of its forms, including neocolonialism and imperialism. For example, in 1994, we dislodged the regime of apartheid national oppression, which represented the internal colonizer. However, the fact that we have elected a government in power by democratic means does not mean that government is free to implement the program for which we put it in power. That government was inserted in that position in the context of state dependency on capital, in the context where both in South Africa and internationally, capital is centered and concentrated in the hands of a few. And there are no resources to advance the implementation of the vision we struggled for are not sufficient. And therefore, we are still compelled to go to the class forces which were behind oppression and imperialist domination for capital to advance development. This has devastated the entire African continent through structural adjustment programs imposed by the International Monetary Fund, imposed by the World Bank, and imposed by imperialist capital, setting conditionalities for investment. And the direction of capital under these conditions is such that less is advanced and more is pulled out, and the relations of underdevelopment continue to be reproduced. As things stand right now, two years just after we dislodged the apartheid regime, a neoliberal policy was imposed, and a policy we all agreed upon was shelved. That marked the beginning of a long decade of struggle within the alliance. Okay. That long period of struggle within the alliance culminated in 2007 in changes of leadership in the African National Congress. Secondly, a year later, culminated in the recall of the president through the power of the people led by the alliance and his replacement by the new president. Now, the neoliberal policy that was imposed there did not help us address the structural problems created by capitalist exploitation and imperialist oppression, such as high levels of class inequality, high levels of poverty, high levels of unemployment. These were reproduced, all right? Now, it is in this context, following the 2009 elections, where as the alliance we agreed to implement what we call the second, more radical phase of our democratic transition, meaning that the first phase dislodged apartheid. The second phase must deliver freedom to the people and freedom to the government that the people shall determine in a democratic election, and freedom to the people using organs of people's power in community to implement the program of development and transformation. There are several things in conclusion which we would like to highlight. At least all people struggling for democracy can learn something from us so that they do not repeat some of the mistakes we have committed. But some of these mistakes, as I have said, were imposed by what I call structural limitations of power. One, from 1994, imperialist capital has penetrated the economy of South Africa in all spheres. Two, capital from other countries or areas of the world which were not part of the traditional Western European and Northern American and Japanese imperialism has come in the country and is also entrenching. This has been facilitated by the fact that world governments are being placed into competition with one another for investment. And in that process, the struggle invites capital penetration and postpones conditions for liberation by means of imperialist exploitation. Secondly, there has been class configuration of the South African society in that from amongst the historically oppressed, there emerged a layer of intermediary capitalists who are compradorial in their position and location and are subordinate to both the established white monopoly capital in South Africa and imperialist capital, and they have some fractions of equity. Going forward, this has got a negative impact ideologically and politically on our movement. Locally, there is a new strata of the capitalist class that is heavily dependent on state contracts called tenders, hence the term tenderpreneurs by the state. It also exerts a negative influence over the ideological orientation and the political direction of the movement. And linked with all of this is a new problem of rising corruption, which must be dealt with. It is mostly when people are in power that sometimes you get to be in a better position to understand their true nature and character. Just finally, because my time is up, between 1994 and to date, despite the many challenges that we have gone through and despite the many challenges that we have, a lot of progress has been made in implementing our vision of progressive politics, the Freedom Charter. Over 3.3 million houses have been built for free for the people in a population of 53 million people. These houses benefit over 17.5 million people. Electricity in the past was connected only to white households. Between 94 and today, we connected over 7 million households. We expanded education to near universal access for children, for all children. And over and above our original vision, millions of children receive meals for free at school so that they don't land on a hungry stomach. We massively expanded access to technical education and vocational training and universities, and over 1.4 million students have received financial assistance from the state. The majority of students in colleges and universities to date is constituted by the African majority and black people in general who were suppressed and denied that access. Thank you very much.
Ja, vielen Dank an Alex Mobotswane Mashilo. Das war wirklich sehr erhellend und interessant. Und wir sehen mal wieder, es gibt eine weltweite Vernetzung des Kapitals und auch wir hier in den Metropolen müssen endlich etwas dafür tun, dass das aufhört. Wir haben natürlich noch sehr viele Fragen. Zum Beispiel die Rolle der Frauen ist jetzt hier nicht thematisiert worden. Aber wir sind sicher, also Kurdistan kann auch sehr viel lernen von den Problemen, die in Südafrika, die Organisationen in Südafrika haben und hatten. Und wir sagen, Amandla, Awesatu, Power to the People.